Welcome everyone to another recording of Fun With Films. We're back for a celebration of all things excellent about the small and big screen. We're here to welcome you to a celebration once again of the creative work of filmmakers out there, but importantly, to have fun with film. This is our third video magazine, and my co-host is back.
Hi, guys. Hi, Pascal. I'm Paul, pleased to be back, and today we have our third episode, and it's a Halloween special because tomorrow is Halloween 2021. So I'm looking forward to getting scared and spooky with you.
Absolutely. So this is a horror-themed video magazine. We're going to be going through our usual segment. If you are new to the video magazine, please stick around. At the end, we have our Riddle Me This, Riddle Me That quiz, which would be all about horror
very
films.
Very popular.
Yes, absolutely. We're going to be back in time looking at the very first horror film that scared Paul and I. We're going to tell you what those are. We're going to have the big question. You're going to be revealing more about ourselves. I think they said we're going to reveal more of ourselves.
Be careful.
I'm going to ask Paul a question. He's going to ask me a question. You're going to learn more about us as your host of Fun With Films. We're going to be talking about a very special movie coming out soon in Trailer Talk, and we'll begin shortly with The Watchmen, where we've been making selection of what we want you to watch.
So, just in case you're wondering what the Watchmen have been watching, you're going to find out right now. Okay, here we go. First up.
So, your selection, Paul, we begin with this movie. Tell us more.
Well, this was one of those little hidden gem movies that when you're flicking through, this is on Netflix, I was flicking through Netflix, and I came across it and I was kind of like, I don't know. And I gave it a shot and I was absolutely blown away by everything in this movie. It's produced by Guillermo del Toro, so the visual style, the color palette is absolutely gorgeous. The director has done a fantastic job, and it's essentially based on some kids' books. So the best way to describe it is probably Stranger Things meets The Goonies or Stranger Things meets Goosebumps. It's kind of that vibe, and it's very, very cool in that it can be watched by maybe teen and adults, and neither are going to be scared witless, but all of it kind of get creeped out at times, and both groups will enjoy it. So the basic premise is a young girl, Stella, and her friends meet up with a mysterious drifter, and they find a book written by Sarah Bellows, and this book was her diary, and she is with like a local legend, a local scary story, you know, haunted house kind of Sarah Bellows. And when Sarah Bellows writes in this book, the scary stories that she writes come true, and it's the adventures of our heroes dealing with these scary stories. And it's very clever in that they take a lot of horror tropes, a lot of different horror tropes, and shoehorn it into one cool story. So there's the ghost element, there's the scarecrow element, as you can see on screen. There's the jangly man. That was brilliant, by the way. Just watch it for the jangly man. It's fantastic. It's like, it was one of those. There's so many elements, the haunted house. It does everything so well and everybody can enjoy it, but it isn't an outright gore fest. It's just beautiful to look at, creepy and wonderful. Give it a shot.
Okay, so that's Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark, is that right?
Yes.
Netflix?
Yes, based on a book series.
Super. So if you just joined us live, I'm checking also on our Facebook page. This is first segment of Fun With Films. This is our third monthly video magazine. And this is Watchmen. We would like you to watch what we've been watching.
So what have you been watching?
I've got a lovely surprise from Amazon Prime.
What we got?
The Vast of Night.
Ooh.
Now, The Vast of Night is a wonderful homage, just use a French word to begin with, to the sci-fi series you saw on TV from the 50s and 60s. You have a Twilight Zone, you have a bit of a fifth dimension element to it. It's also inspired by an event that took place in New Mexico in the 1950s. And you follow the story of a kind of phone operator back in the 50s, you know, the ladies that would just use different cables and what a network. And you have also a radio DJ who hear a very, very strange noise. And they play the noise back on the radio. And what they get, people calling back who have heard that noise before many years ago.
Oh, wow.
And that noise was linked to events, which I won't spoil for you. And it is a story of those two young individuals on a mission to understand what happened in the past, but also what is happening right now, that night, with that noise, those strange lights, and so on and so forth. And it's back to your point about the film you mentioned. It is superbly filmed.
Yeah.
It's also, I would say, an audio experience. Just to let you know, for example, when the young lady gets a phone call from an old army veteran who explained what he went through many years in the past with that same noise, and the camera is just transfixed on her for the entire 10 minutes, and all you can do, therefore, is listen to the caller tell his story, and it just creeps you out. So it's actually one where you're going to enjoy the way it was filmed, but you're also going to enjoy listening very carefully to what the callers are saying.
Is it a series or a film?
It's a film.
A film.
Done by, I think, to be a first-time filmmaker. And that guy and his team needs to be credited because it just looks absolutely and sounds absolutely amazing. The Vast of Night.
Is it a 15?
I'm going to go, it's a 15.
Yeah.
But I would say to be watched by a mature audience who's going to enjoy filmmaking, good storytelling, and but a bit like yours, there isn't much in terms of make you jump.
Yeah.
You're going to really appreciate, and it's going to get to you. Particularly the very end.
Creepy, that kind of. Oh, ooh, we got it. We got to watch it.
Okay, so what have you got for Watchmen next?
Next up, let's have a look. Which one's next? Oh, wow. This blew me away. I love foreign cinema. I love period foreign cinema. So anything that is kind of the Chinese medieval period, samurai period or whatever, and this is something the Korean medieval period, the sword, you know, period, I don't know a huge amount about, and I haven't seen a lot about, but this is just wonderful. It's called Kingdom, not to be mixed up with Frank Grillo's Kingdom about MMA, and it's a kind of infected stroke zombie story set in the backdrop of political intrigue in the palace and kingdom in Korea, in kind of the 1500s, I believe it is. And it's just amazing. The zombies in this are more like Zack Snyder's Dawn of the Dead stroke 28 Days Later. They move quick and gruesome, and it's really creepy. It's got a little bit of The Grudge in it, the way they move. And it's a wonderful mix. It's a series, by the way, a wonderful mix of real kind of gory, creepy zombies running around killing people and political intrigue of what's going on in the palace. So the king is ill, and his young concubine wife is keeping some secrets about what's going on with that, and she and her family are trying to take over the throne, and the crown prince is being pushed out by her and her family and her advisors. So there's this whole political thing going on with them and the family, and is he going to lose his inheritance, which is, you know, to become king? But there's also this plague, this zombie plague that's overtaking the kingdom too, and what's going to happen to the people, and is he going to step up and become, you know, the king he should be? And then will he be able to be the king? It's just fantastic, and it's so beautifully filmed, it's so beautifully lit, it's lavish. The sets, they used actual palaces, Korean palaces, are just incredible, and at times it makes you jump clean out the seat. You know, it's one of those ones. Everything about it is brilliant. I think each episode was something like $1.78 million per episode, and it's all on screen. Don't let the fact that it's Korean and it's subtitled ruin it. Please watch it. It's amazing from start to finish. And I believe there's a spin-off movie just come out.
That's right, yeah.
which is a side story to it as well. So even though they've ran two seasons, and I think they've told the tale, they're bringing in side projects about that world as well, which is really cool.
Well, so I've not seen any of that because, you know, I'm more of an Amazon Prime posse. I'm not the Netflix nanny of with films. I just want to quickly say hello to James Mello, who joined the live recording. Hi, James.
Hiya.
James Mello is an accomplished filmmaker and video producer. He's got an amazing track record in the world of cinema. And I believe you gave your thumbs up to The Vast of Night. Thank you very much for that. For that one, what intrigues me, and I definitely going to put it on my watch list, Paul, is the idea of I've never seen the zombie genre in that time period. I don't think. I've seen movies, but not a series.
It's absolutely amazing because they're limited with what they can use to stop this plague. And it's very clever in how they explain where it comes from and how it started too. And how they tie it into the king. It's just beautifully written, beautifully acted. It's beautiful, but it's very, very well written and takes an often used genre and injects some new life and new ideas into it.
So once again, this is the horror special of Film with Films. And so far, we've chosen beautiful films whilst being still in the horror genre. I'm going to take you back to the present, also in the near enough present with this masterpiece from Jordan Peele.
I haven't seen this.
Oh my world, you are in for a treat. So Jordan Peele will be known to others by doing all manner of movies, including comedy. But I have to tell you, Us is the one that really, really got under my skin. So very, very quickly, this is the story of the Wilson family who are having a lovely summer break. They live north, obviously, I think it's California. They're about. They go back home to enjoy a lovely kind of family evening. There's mum and dad, there's the teenage daughter and the younger son. And then I think it is the younger son who spots that there is dark silhouettes in outside the house.
Creepy.
And his words are, there is a strange-looking family outside. And as the movie can reveal itself, what they are confronted with, and they are essentially being attacked by their own doppelgangers. And not just them, but the neighbors, the whole town seems to suddenly have been attacked by a version of themselves. And back to your point earlier about how they move and how they sound and everything is just so incredibly scary. They move like almost like insects. It's very, very kind of jittery. the doppelganger, if you like, you know, the opposite of the mum, keeps holding on to a massive pair of scissors and she's forever snapping them in people's faces to scare them. The noise that the scissors make is just truly scary. I won't say any more because I think I may start to spoil the story.
Yeah.
But essentially it's about, well, how will the family survive the ongoing assault into their property, trying to get inside the house and so on and so forth, but how will they also resolve the problem of knowing who's who?
Yeah, the thing I think with film as well, and especially horror film, is people don't give the right sound enough credit. And sound is amazing. If it's not right in a horror film especially, you lose all of the tension, all of the fear. So, you know, that...
And what is fascinating is many of you recognize both the family, the actor, particularly the adults, from the Marvel Universe and more. You recognize some of the neighbors from... But that will not distract you. Within moments, you're sucked into their lives, the Wilson family, and you just want them to survive and succeed. But each time they try... It's just absolutely wonderful. And at the end, like all of us who watch it for the first time, your mind's going to be completely blown. And there's some lovely, as you mentioned, lovely reference and homage to all the other horror classics. But also Jordan Peele does things that only he can do. The name may be familiar because, of course, he was behind Get Out and all the others.
Yeah.
But
I've never seen that, actually.
Not?
No, I haven't seen that.
You could do a double bill between Us and Get Out.
Yeah. I kind of went off horror movies for a long time because I watched so many when I was a kid. And it's very, very difficult to find one that's original. And a lot of the kind of ones about ghosts or this or that or the other, you've seen it before. This sounds great. It sounds really, really unusual and original. So I'm going to go out of my way to watch this.
And what is interesting, I once again, I need to compliment the filmography. So we've chosen, this is the fourth one, if I'm not mistaken, we're mentioning in Watchmen. And each one of them we actually praised the cinematography.
Yeah.
I think that's very interesting about the horror films. They will film and use light very well, won't they?
Yeah, the sound, but also the lighting makes the whole film. Mm. We watched something, it is a little off topic, me and my sweetheart Joe watched a film on Netflix called Escape Room a little mm-hmm. while ago. Mm-hmm. And it's a cool film. It's a really cool film. I really enjoyed everything about it, but the lighting and the color palette is so rich. You're absolutely captivated looking around these rooms. Sometimes you got to kind of stop and go, oh, I missed what the character was doing because it's so well lit, so beautiful. The color palette's so rich that you're drawn into it. And I think these days that's what makes you sometimes go back to watch a film a second or a third time because there's so much to see. So it is important.
Super. So let's go for your final selection. For
Righty-ho, what is Watchmen. It? Yes. Oh, right.
I've not seen this one.
Mm. Look at the image on there. What does that remind you of?
just
for the audience, this guy here is a filmmaker in his own right, and an early poster for the second movie.
Yep.
He pretty much produced, directed, and I kind of had a little hand in. Looked a lot like this.
It was made by my brother Yannick. He did that for us as a teaser poster.
So close as well. You'll have to dig that out. This movie called Cargo essentially is very, very different, very introverted, and it's a very closed story. In a big area, because it's set in the Australian outback, but it's a very, very closed story about one guy, Martin Freeman, we'll know from The Hobbit and Sherlock, wonderful, wonderful actor. He plays a father who's trying to carry his daughter through the outback while there is some kind of viral, again, it's kind of 28 days later, stroke zombie infection going on. People are dying by the droves, and he is trying to get his daughter to safety. It's beautifully filmed. Very, very new film team, director, and this, that, and the other. And Martin Freeman carries this whole film on his back as well as his daughter. It literally is about him for 90% of it. And there is some scary scenes as such, but it's not one of those films. It's not going to make you jump. It's not massive on gore for all the viral infected don't look particularly pleasant or whatever. It's the realism of thinking about what would you do in that situation. It's that type of film. It's a lot more mature. It's a lot more of an adult film. And essentially, trying not to give too much of a spoiler, he is bitten.
Okay.
And the story is, who is he going to get to look after his daughter before he turns? And the anguish, the panic, everything is there on his face during this whole film. And if you put yourself in that place, that's horrific. What would you do? It's wonderful. It's quite dark and quite gritty, and it's a realism-based horror film. And it's wonderful. And Freeman was outstanding from start to finish. I loved every minute of it.
Super. Well, that's what we're trying to do with Watchmen, is highlight some of our discoveries that may be tucked away behind maybe some of the more prominent, the way in which Netflix, Amazon Prime, Disney Plus, and all the others, they usually push what's already working well.
Yeah.
Sometimes the expense of some real gems such as this one. Thanks very much. I'm going to be looking for this. So I'm going to mention my very last for Watchmen, and this is The House of the Devil.
Film? Series? Film?
This is a film. Film. All of them are films. I love the artwork of the poster, and it suggests to you, once again, let's pay homage to the classic of the 70s and the 80s. Now, this was made more recently by, I think it's T. West. This is how you pronounce his first name, T. West. And the name would be familiar because he's done other horror movies and also TV series. And the story follows a student who needs cash and in money and replies to an advert for a babysitting job. a couple needs to go out, strangely, the night or the full moon. I mean, frankly, you know, that would already be a hint by not taking the job. A friend of hers drives her to the house, and you look at the house from the curb and you go, I am not going to that house. And you go up to the door, you knock on the door, the couple, the Ullman, Mr. and Mrs. Ullman, open the door and recognize them as most horror films feature those two characters. And you still walk into the house to take on the job of babysitting. While she's sat there having maybe a quick drink before the couple goes out, and they are very, very strange, and they ask you very strange questions, whilst you go at the table, by the way, we lied to you, it's not quite babysitting, it's looking after this our elderly mother who is upstairs, but guess what? She doesn't need any help from you. All you have to do is stay in a house, order a pizza, and all will be well. And... of course,
it's not. It's not well.
Now, I'm presenting this in jest, but I have to tell you, a wonderful, creepy movie, like they used to do them, and I think that's what's so pleasant about it.
Yeah.
It's the house, it's the noise, it's what's upstairs where she's not allowed to go, or suddenly told not to go. It's the weird couple and everything that goes on where she tries to get help. It's just really, really well put together. And I would say for a Halloween night, it's probably actually quite a strong contender.
Yeah.
The House of the Devil.
What is it about horror films that people like? Why do we even like horror films? I just add as well, my girlfriend doesn't. She used to when she was younger, but she is such a wuss. So last night I was like, Joe, come on. Let's watch a horror film. I never get to see a horror film anymore. And I don't watch them that often now, but I really feel like watching one at Halloween. Let's watch a horror film. What should we watch? She said, either Beetlejuice or Hocus Pocus. Yeah. That's the level of scare she is capable these days. So we didn't watch any of that anyway. Super. But what is it? Why do you like them? What is it about being scared?
I think it's such an experience. I mean, even after all these years. Oh, by the way, just saying that James Miller very kindly suggested The Howling. He's going to watch that tomorrow.
The original?
In 4K.
Yeah.
That's going to be looking. And he's rediscovering horror. Like many people are.
Yeah, I am. I'm going back and watching a lot of things that scared the living bejesus out of me, but I haven't seen since I was a kid. And The Howling and Silver Bullet as well were absolutely amazing. Wolfen was good. And American Werewolf in London, you know, stick dirt roads, lads, stick dirt roads. I remember going, no, don't go off the road.
So for me, it's because almost like the opposite of an action movie, you root for the characters, the heroes. I mean, typically, although sometimes you may
even... Yeah, no, kill him.
You may cheer when Tony gets slapped by Jason Voorhees. But so for me, the storytelling is usually vastly superior to other genres. We spoke about the cinematography already, the music sometimes.
Yeah, the music. John Carpenter.
Oh, come on.
You know. Every time.
And yeah, you get that moment of doom. It's like, you know, why I don't do that, but why do people go on scary rides?
Yeah, I don't get it. I'd rather watch a horror movie.
Basically, as we see where I come from, that frisson that makes you feel alive. The same way you watch an action film and you're rooting for the heroes or watching good fight scene.
For me, a lot of it was the inventiveness of horror films that I liked. I mean, look at Nightmare on Elm Street. The whole idea of, you know, he came into your dreams and you couldn't go to sleep, and all of that was so original. It hadn't really been done before. And that's what I liked. Whereas, you know, an action movie, for all I love them, the guy goes out for revenge because, you know, blah, blah. You've seen it. But I think that's my problem with a lot of modern horror film is they're not that inventive the way they were. But when you get one that is, it's just wonderful. I
mean, most indie filmmakers have honed their craft and understand how to be ingenious through horror films. I mean, Sam Raimi with The Evil Dead is the ultimate masterclass in indie filmmaking.
Yeah.
So just for
and friends, Romero.
Yeah, very true, very true. For our friends joining us live, please drop us in the comments your go-to kind of Halloween stroke horror films. But also, we'd like to know what is the very first horror film that you saw that really, really scared you.
Hocus Pocus doesn't count, by the way, at all, ever.
So we've got Peter Barton, I think, still James with us, and a couple of others. So drop your name, your go-to horror film for maybe tomorrow night, but also the very first one you watched maybe as a child, hiding behind cushions and more. Maybe you had a...
Hang on a minute. You can't watch a horror film as a child if it's an 18.
I think I did.
I mean, who does that?
I think that's why I'm still scarred to life. But yeah. The one I mentioned later on. So that is the end of Watchmen. What we've been watching, and we would like you to watch too. It is time, Paul.
It is time.
To make our way down the carpet-strewed... What's the expression again? Carefully
the popcorn-strewn carpet, yes. Towards the cinema of awesomeness to get ready for some trailer talk. Did we pulled it out of the bag.
Oh, I love these dramatic stings. So in trailer talk, Ron and I choose a trailer of the forthcoming film. So something that is about to appear on the big and small screen, which is what they do nowadays. And this is a trailer that I've only seen once about a year ago when they tried to release this film once. There's been other trailers, but I think they're quite spoily in nature. So what we're going to do is play the trailer and we'll come back to review Rent and Rave.
I haven't actually seen this trailer at all, so this is brand new to me, fresh to me, so looking at it with fresh eyes, let's roll it.
What are you doing here in Somerville anyway?
Honestly, my mom won't say it, but we're completely broke. And the only thing that's left in our name is this creepy old farmhouse our grandfather left us in the middle of nowhere. Why'd you bring me up here?
Entertainment value.
What is that?
I don't know.
Somehow, a town that isn't anywhere near a tectonic plate, that has no fault lines, no fracking, no loud music even, is shaking on a daily basis.
Under the dining table now! Hey, remember that one summer we died under a table?
I found this in my living room.
Whoa, killer replica.
A replica of what?
A ghost trap? There hasn't been a ghost sighting in 30 years. New York in the 80s, it's like The Walking Dead. Your dad never mentioned this to you?
It's just my mom. My grandfather died. My mom says we're just here to pick through the rubble of his life.
Wait a minute. Who are you?
Call it fate. Call it luck. Call it karma. I believe that everything happens for a reason.
Come on, darling.
It has a gunner seat?
Wow. Yeah, Ghostbusters 1 and 2, iconic. Mm-hmm. Take us back pretty much to childhood, the type of film that everybody loves. They tried to reboot it a few years ago. Uh-huh. Pretty much universally panned by everybody. I haven't seen it, so in all honesty, I don't know. I never bothered watching it. But that right there is a lesson in how to keep people happy that were fans of the original film.
I like that. Yeah, how to keep people happy. Yeah.
I mean, that is, they basically made that film for us who saw the film first time around, but have made it accessible for new audiences as well. That's how you reboot a franchise or make a new film. I'm so looking forward to seeing that. And just the minute you hear that siren, it just takes you back to the first time you ever watched Ghostbusters.
It's just amazing. So I absolutely agree with you. This is almost the sequel, if you consider it as a term that nobody's asked for,
yeah,
that everybody wants to watch now. There's respect in terms of what was done before. They brought everything that makes the Ghostbusters brand, because it is such a thing now,
yeah,
work, and they're going to, I think, tell the story really, really well. I avoided looking at the other trailers. I think there's been another one or two trailers. There's been other things going out there because I didn't want the story to be spoiled, but there's plenty going on here. So we basically know that, A, they've discovered the ambulance. Was it an ambulance originally? Was it a...
I think so. I think so.
So they've found the protopacks. They've found the traps. Slimer is obviously being chased. There's a hint of those demonic dogs that we saw in the first one with the gatekeeper and the key master, which I almost wish Rick Moranis would be in this one as well. I just love it when he's organizing that party and he's flat in the first one. It's just so, so good. And I think the main reason why we can look forward to this one is because it is a family affair.
Yeah.
Yeah. So on the left, we've got the man behind the first two, Ivan Reitman. And on the right, his son, Jason. I mean, that must be feels very special to work on that.
Also quite daunting, you know. You've got these two iconic movies that the reboot has already fell flat on its face. Your dad made the originals and the reins have been handed to you and it's kind of, son, don't mess it up. You know, it would be very, very stressful on Jason Reitman. But from the looks of it, it looks like he's done a lot more right than he's done wrong, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, yeah. I think that you're right. You know, there's so much there for the fans of the first one. I mean, put it this way, the first one was 84, if I'm not mistaken, then 89 for the second one. So this story is taking place 30 years later. I even got excited, I had to check it, when you hear from the trailer that they're moving to their granddad's property.
Yeah.
And for a moment, I thought, oh, is that Dan Aykroyd's property? Because, you know, in the first one, he has to remortgage his parents' house to be able to finance their first kind of undertaking. But that's not. It's actually the character of Harold Ramis, who sadly, you know, passed away a few years ago. So that's that part of the family. The one thing that makes me a fraction nervous, only because I want it to be so right, I've heard rumors that all the other characters from the first one and second one, including Sigourney Weaver, are going to be in this one.
Yeah.
Now, they're not in the trailer at all, maybe because they wanted to keep the surprise, but because of the delays of COVID and so on, they couldn't keep it much longer. And I hope that they're not just going to appear at the very end as a token gesture.
Yeah.
They're going to be part of the story.
Well, I hope as well they're not going to be in as cameos in the background. I hope they're in as the actual characters themselves. But to me, I'm willing to give this a shot simply because when you want to reboot a franchise, when you want to take something that is an absolute classic, instead of recasting it in, you know, a politically correct, different way and doing the film, to me, the best way to do it is a handover film. And this is what they're doing. They're taking the original story, the original cast and crew, and somehow handing it over to the next generation where it keeps everybody happy. And that's what they've done here. They've devised a story around carrying on the world and the mythos of that world that they live in with ghosts and handing it down to the next generation. And that's the way to make this kind of movie. It doesn't destroy the first one, and it doesn't just try and redo the first one differently for the sake of doing it. It continues the story, and I think that is why I'm excited to watch it.
I think the casting of Paul Rudd is also a smart move, and it's got nothing to do with his previous work, but actually him as an actor and the character of the teacher at school, who at first may not believe the kids, but then he himself... Well, actually, Paul Rudd, as the man, has grown up with watching Ghostbusters. Allegedly, the teacher, I think he's a physics teacher, knows about the real Ghostbusters, and these are the ones showing on the VHS cassette and video clips from the 1980s. So I think someone like him to make that bridge between the generation, I think it's going to be I think it's a smart move.
I think he's also kind of becoming the generation's Tom Hanks. Man. You know, he's kind of that nice guy in real life, nice guy on film, that you kind of, doesn't matter what he does, you can't help but warm to him. And that is perfect for this type of film. He just is the right type of casting for it. He can do serious drama, he can do comedy. And, you know, I think he's written off sometimes like Tom Hanks was when he was making that shift from comedy films to serious films. People didn't really think it was going to work. And I do think Paul Rudd is in a similar vein, honestly. I think he's, one day he's going to make a film that's going to surprise everybody. And people will take him more seriously instead of just going, oh, he's quite funny. I think he's very talented.
Super. Everybody who's watching us live and on replay in the comments, let us know how you feel. Are you looking forward to this? Are you a little nervous, be like me? Are you thinking this is a wonderful way to start the Christmas period with a movie such as this one? What I will say is when Ivan Reitman was being interviewed, he did say they were keen to make it a fraction darker than in the past. Because he felt that time had passed. And then in a way, he felt that Slimer and all the other monsters had become a bit cute and almost felt part of the family, and they wanted to create more of this sense of threat from what he was doing there.
I think actually that's a genius as well, because we all know, going back to Nightmare on Elm Street as well, first one was very psychological and very scary. By the time you got the third or the fourth, it'd become a parody, that'd become silly. And they tried to just get bigger and more elaborate, but they didn't have the character development, didn't have the story, and they didn't keep it contained in a way that made it scary. And I think actually for the new movie to darken it down a little bit and go and really push that element, I think is absolute genius and much needed too.
So prediction from you before we wrap up on Trailer Talk. We saw a hint of the demonic dog. The dog that we saw in the first one, when the demigod Gozer, the Gozorian, is obviously with a woman, by the way. It surprises, you know, our hero. Do you think, therefore, we're going to see return of Gozer, and this is maybe unfinished business?
I don't know, but I hope not.
Okay.
I hope they're going to give us something a little new, and that's what I would prefer. Yourself? Do you want Gozer?
I just make it the limit to the dogs and Gozer. And we've got Slimer. I'm sure we're going to see the Marshmallow Man as well, maybe just as a little, not back as the monster.
Yeah,
maybe
something
that the kids are going to eat, not realising that he was obviously part of.
Or maybe a little footage of the 80s. And I would like, maybe if they're going to use some kind of demonic possession or demon or whatever, I would say maybe give me something new. But it depends on the story. If it's all of the old ghosts being released, then maybe some of the old ones will come back, and
possibly, and then that may obviously explain why our heroes and Dana, played by Sigourney Weaver, are going to come back to help the younger people to once again vanquish Gozer. We've got some reaction from our friends online, so I believe James Miller is saying, so looking forward to seeing this relating to this movie. We've got Susan Camp. It's been a while, Susan, who's saying Hills Have Eyes, maybe being the one that scared the most when she was maybe a lot younger. In joke from James saying, I'm off for a pint of the slaughtered lamb.
Stick to the roads, James.
Peter, say House on Haunted Hill.
Yeah, the original.
I remember that. James Miller likes the trailer, saying the version keeps the mystique. And Nicolas Sicaf from France saying, I think this is a good idea to cast the actor of Stranger Things.
Yeah.
I would agree. It's going to bring something to the story.
That kid is so talented. So talented and funny and dry. And again, I can't wait to see what kind of things he does as he grows. It'll be amazing. Right.
Okay.
On to our third section. This is a part of the show that I always get a little bit scared at. God knows what he's going to come out with. But it's the big question where we find out a little bit more about each other, and so do you. Whose turn is it to go first?
I don't remember.
No, I don't remember.
To our friends watching us live or on replay, this is the part of the show where Paul and I have shared many, many movie adventures over nearly two decades now. Actually, it'd be more than two decades. We're not counting anymore. We'll just say decades because... And
because
there's still
we're
things maybe that we don't know about each other, but for you to discover more about your host of Fun with Films, reminder, this is the horror special. This is Mirror 3 of Fun with Films, the monthly video magazine. So we aren't going to coin because, of course, we've gone all contactless.
That's payment. What we did last time. We rolled a dice, didn't we?
So roll the dice.
Come on then. Ready?
Yep.
So you go first.
I go first.
I won, you all go right. First.
Okay. So this being a horror special, Paul Gray, founder of Firepower Gym and health and wellness consultant extraordinaire, but also an accomplished martial artist. And if I was ever in trouble and if I was ever chased by horrible creatures, I would have you by my side.
I got your back.
Thank you very much.
I got your back.
Well, hang on. You don't know what's chasing me.
I can run faster than him. So, that's all we need to know.
I want to present to you three scenarios.
Okay.
And I want you to choose which one could you happily defend me against, because you know you've got this.
Right.
Which one would you say, it's going to be 50-50? And which one would you say, I'm sorry, mate, you're on your own?
Come on.
So let me bring on screen your adversaries. So we have,
right,
position it a bit better for you. We have Freddy Krueger.
Yep.
You're the next one.
Jason.
And
Mr. Myers. Not Mike Myers. Yeah, baby. Very, yeah. Michael Myers. Mm.
So Freddy Krueger, Jason Voorhees, or Mike Myers. Which one do you think you can take on and you'll be fine?
Right. Well, Freddy is the weediest out of these three, the smallest by far. Mm-hmm. But those blades,
yeah,
them's razor sharp. a little bit of behind the scenes on that. Robert Englund, the first time he tried, actually went
and cut himself.
And cut himself, the razor sharp. So I think I would avoid Freddy for that reason. Then it comes down to Jason and Michael, who are very similar, really. They're both big, unkillable, but do come back. You know what? I think Jason, I'd be able to take.
Okay, thank you.
I've seen him cut to pieces so many times, I think, I could take him.
So which one would be 50-50?
Michael. I don't know why, but I always warmed more to Michael in the horror films than I did Jason. I think Michael's, I don't know, he's the shape. He's just a little bit more menacing, a little bit scarier. I think he's got the edge over Jason. For me, I think he'd be harder to deal with.
So if Freddy was to appear in our dreams, do you think that's where it is? You would leg it.
Basically, have you seen me without sleep?
Hmm.
Can't cope.
Mm.
Freddy would absolutely decimate me.
Okay, good to know. So just to recap,
yep,
you'll take on Mike Myers. Is that what you said?
50-50.
50-50. So Jason, you'll take on.
Take on Jason,
But Freddy, you run away.
Run away. You run your own with him. You run your own. Sorry. I'm not dealing with that.
Well, that's rather disappointing. So if you think you could take on Freddy Krueger and protect me, can you please put that in the comments, either live right now or in the replay on YouTube. Right, Monsieur Gray. What is
right.
your question for me?
Okay, so we're going to have a little scenario here.
Mm.
And this will tell you a lot about Pascal. Pick your favorite movie that you would like to see again at the cinema, just real quick.
Okay. Well, am I telling you?
Yeah, tell me.
Warriors.
Warriors. Okay, so you go to the cinema, special screening of the Warriors. The actors from the Warriors are there beforehand talking about the film.
Yeah.
You've looked forward to this for years. Mm. You go in, you sit down in the cinema, and you're surrounded by the worst bunch of people ever. You've got nose pickers. You've got that kind of eaters. You've got kids. They're talking. They've got their phones.
Are they kicking my chair?
They're kicking your chair. They're wiping their nose on the chair. They're throwing sweets. This is Pascal's worst nightmare. If you ever go to the cinema with Pascal, if somebody breathes, he hates them. This is the learning process we're going here.
I wish this could be actually an exaggeration.
So you sat there, right? Mm-hmm. Would you rather sit through that whole experience trying to hear what's going on and watch the film? And by the way, Would You Rather is an amazing film with Jeffrey Combs from 2012 that uses this concept. Mm-hmm. So please look up Would You Rather. I think Squid Games kind of stole it a little bit. Would you rather sit through that whole experience or eat the Baba Yaga's toenails from Hellboy?
If I eat the Baba Yaga's toenail from Hellboy, do they go away and I can watch Warriors?
Yes.
I'll do it.
I knew it, and he would.
Yeah.
He seriously would.
I would just chew on the toenails all the way through the film. I would even do it for the director's cut even longer if they can all leave me alone.
In peace. To watch the film and listen to the Warriors. Now, what have we found out about Pascal?
Yeah, absolutely. So that's the big questions. Do you have any more questions for your host of Fun With Films? A reminder, this is the horror special. If you are joining us live or on replay, leave in the comments your number one, the first film that really, really scared you. And see if there's any more comments.
And also, Would You Rather? That's a great game to play with friends at a dinner party. And watch the movie as well. It's cool.
Okay. So what we have now is time to go into the DeLorean of Dreams and travel back in time. So this is an extra long Back in Time segment where we tell you about the films that we used to watch at a much tender age. And we've gone for, of course, the horror films that really, really scared us. We're not going to give you the details as we've done in other segments. We're just going to go through them. But just maybe a story about where you were and maybe how old you were. So this is your first selection, Paul. This movie... scared you.
And one thing I want to explain about this as well, when it comes to kind of any genre of films with us, and okay, we're going to do a horror special, I mean, there's so many horror films that we love, and if it came down to pick your favorites, we'd never ever do it. So by posing the question of which one or what was the earliest memories of being scared by a horror film, it made us easier to choose. And one of the first, Salem's Lot, the Stephen King adaptation. And I'll just look at my notes. When was this again? 1979. Yeah. Oh, my God. I was kind of 5 or 6 years old when this came out. And it's a slow film. Mm. It's a long film, and it's a slow film by today's standards. Yeah, it builds attention in a very, very old-fashioned kind of Hammer horror old-school way, which a lot of people don't enjoy these days, but I do because I was brought up with it, and I've got the patience to invest in the characters. David Soul was amazing, but I've only ever seen this film, I think, once or twice, and I haven't seen it since I was a kid. And the memory of waking up at night with the scene with the little vampire kid floating outside the window and kind of scratching on the glass. You know, I'd go to my curtains and it's like, oh, he's not there. I just remember it freaked me out. You know, I mean, I was way too young to be watching this kind of thing, but I loved it. And then I would rewatch that scene, you know, before the VHS movie had to go back, you know. It scared me big time.
I got scared watching this. I mean, even if I was a fraction older than you. And for me, it was just the slow pace, but the character of James Mason was so sinister as well, playing obviously the character that was would help the count. I think was it a count?
Yeah,
the reveal of the vampire with those front.
Well, it was very Nosferatu as well, wasn't it? The look of the vampire was not like Dracula being the count and looking all suave with a little pointy fang here, which wasn't really that scary. This looked scary. It looked really freakish, and it owed a lot to the 1922 Nosferatu. And it does deviate from the book. In the book, it's not like that. And Stephen King had a little bit of a problem with that at first, until he saw it and realized that visually it made you care more about the characters. And then he was kind of on board with it. But yeah, it was like, wow. Well,
I mean, we watched it again about a month ago with Denise.
Really?
I wanted to watch something from the past, and it's a very, very enjoyable story to watch. I mean, I had the nostalgia, of course.
Yeah.
But all the scenes I was hoping would still work, they work. And I think it's down to the acting in particular.
I think the thing with the kid at the window as well, from looking at a little bit of... I love watching the behind the scenes. It's funny. I hated it. It scared me. But I would re-watch it all the time. It was like, I love this. This is great. Then I'd go to bed and go, I don't like it anymore. But I think the way they filmed it, they played it in reverse, which made it look really freaky and eerie.
Very clever.
But he wasn't on strings either. Mm. So the kid was on kind of a mechanical arm, like a boom, which made his kind of floating movement look a little more ethereal, so that he wasn't just being, hung up by strings, and you can see where the strings would attach, even if you can't see the strings. You get that visual image.
Think we get it, you got really scarred, mentally scarred by that.
Moving swiftly on.
So for me, the one that scared me, and the very first one I saw at the cinema, it was a local cine club where literally the projector was playing behind your back, and you had to kind of work your way through the sound. And this movie, The Fog, really, really, really scared me. To the point where for several nights and days, I just didn't sleep very well. And I think it was just a sense of dread of, those ghost zombies, creatures from the sea just coming
back. The pirates.
Demanding what was rightly theirs. I think that was also maybe part of the story, which was they were almost right in their quest for vengeance.
Yeah.
So, but again, it was impossible to hide from them. They would always come and knock, and the fog were coming through. At the time, I didn't realize it was obviously... And Jimmy Lee Curtis, who also played in a very first one. It took me a while, but I have found the original poster, because this is not the one, but the one that I saw at the cinema looked more like this.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the scene. Ooh.
Again, it comes back to, I mean, Carpenter does the same thing so many times in so many different films. Like Halloween, Michael was originally just known as The Shape. And there you go. With that, you've got the shape. You don't know what they are. You don't know why they're standing there. You don't know what they're going to do. You don't know whether they're going to go, whether they're going to come after you. And that whole psychological aspect to the visual image works so well. And the best one I think John Carpenter did for me was Prince of Darkness, where they're in the church stuck and the lookout, and there's just all these kind of shapes of people outside standing there on the street. And... oh my God, what they're going to do,
So the fog
brilliant.
Was really the one. I mean, I paid my £5 at the time and I regretted it because I didn't for days and then. And even when the film is over, and I remember I had this feeling where I'd been scared for, and I said, what's this feeling of not going home in the dark and I don't like it. And when you think it's over, and of course at the very end, they come back again because they have one last victim, so to speak, to deal with. So the fog really scared me. So your second choice in terms of the one that really scares you at a younger age is this one, Superstition.
Yeah, this is a film that kind of, I think, went under the radar for many, many people. It's 1982, I believe, 81, 82. And it came on the back of, you know, the big horror boom in the late 70s, the 80s, on the back of John Carpenter films and things like that. And it, the slasher films were becoming very, very popular as well. All the Hills Have Eyes and things like that. Superstition basically did a lot right and a lot that was individual. It was the story of a witch that had been killed, and she was coming back to haunt, stroke, kill everybody that would stay in her house and be in her kind of area where she was killed. And that's the main premise. But it was one of those very early films that used inventiveness in how it killed people. So I always remember being spooked to bits throughout this whole film. It's very, very dated and very 80s and old. And, you know, the music wasn't particularly good. The acting wasn't amazing. There was no major stars in it. Even the cinematography and the lighting was very, very basic. But it worked how they told the story, the jumps, the scares. Not to spoil too much, but there's a head in a microwave at one point, and wow, you know what's going to happen there. You just got to think that through. There's a circular saw that starts going on its own and ends up buried through somebody's chest. And the scene that got me, the one that got me, is at one point, you know, the door shuts by itself, and the guy's trying to get out, and he's trying to get out, and then something moves, he's trying to get out, and he sees the window, and he's like, right, I'm going to get out the window. So he goes, and it's an old-fashioned sash window. And if you watch the trailer for this, if you find it online, you'll see a little kind of clip of this. And it depends if you can find an uncut version of what they show. But he goes to climb out the window, and the sash window goes dunk up, and then it goes kind of dunk, 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 and it cuts him in half. And his body's on one side, and his little legs are wiggling on the other. And this is like 1982. I was 8 years old, you know, watching this. It was like, it absolutely freaked me out when I saw that. It's so scary, but brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
Can't just say enough, every time we've shown the poster, the artwork's always so good,
it's
isn't it?
It's beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah. That's
absolutely beautiful. Well.
So the second movie that pretty much traumatized me when I was a young boy is this one.
I can't remember much of this. I can remember the remake, but I can't remember much of the original.
Oh, the original. Many of you would have seen the Amityville Horror. And yeah, I would argue it's probably not aged very well. I think you watch it now and kind of go, what's all about? Because things like Paranormal Activity and the others have done another job. But it was just, again, this idea of a house, you know, kind of being, and the evilness inside the house, and the family trying to understand what's going on, they're fighting the evil forces, trying to get help from the priest, nothing's working. And for me, it was just the very first time when I saw a family being attacked by the evil forces. But also then when they start to be possessed by the demon, and there's one time where it's a very simple scene, but frightened the life out of me, where they have a babysitter. Of course you do. So babysitter is working there, and the door slams, and she's trapped in there, and she's banging to the point where she's literally bleeding because she's so scared. And simple things like this, you've got the priest played by Rod Steiger, who goes into the house and immediately feels the evil presence and becomes ill. And you've got all those kind of now very common kind of images that were done. But the other thing that really scared me is, as part of the marketing, they did a fake documentary. So allegedly, they were interviewing the family, and allegedly the family said, yeah, this is what happened, and therefore the movie is true. Of course, it's completely false. Well, I didn't know that. So I watched a documentary thinking that it's all true.
Yeah.
Then I watched a film, and then that's me. I mean, like, literally, I probably burst into tears and time after that. I watched the interview, and needed, you know, to be taken somewhere, you know, to be held or something. But again, it's one of those where it's a situation with the people. And this house with those, you know, windows, as you can see here, that have been used time and time again. And I'm sure there's also a musical score that is now attached to the film and into my mind.
Yeah.
As soon as I would hear the first few notes, I would just start to go back to that moment where I got really scared and spooked watching the Amityville Horror.
Have you watched it since? Have you gone back and watched it since? Yeah. It's funny. There's a few of the films that really scared me that I haven't actually gone back, and I do want to. But maybe there's that little block there that I'm not going to. I'm just going to leave it.
What's your second selection then?
Third.
Third. Third, is it?
Third for me. Last one. Fast, aren't we?
All right.
The original Romero version. This was in the 70s as well, 1978. So I was like four when this came out.
You didn't watch it when you were four, sure.
Well, I think I was probably about six or seven, I think. And the thing with this film, obviously, I hadn't seen the first one. This is the second in the trilogy. Was it Night of the Living Dead? I'd never seen that. This was my first introduction to kind of zombie films, as it were. And how it happened was I went round a friend of the family's house. So I used to play with the kids. The guy was a friend of my dad's, and I went round his house to see his sons, which were like mates that I used to hang out with. But they were all older than me, and they put this film on. And I'm like, yeah, this looks cool. What's going on here? And then all of a sudden, there's blue people walking around, which, you know, was supposed to be grey, but on camera they looked blue, didn't they? You know, it was a bit of a learning curve for the makeup people at the time. And blue people walking around, well, that's interesting, blue people. And all of a sudden, you know, they take a bite out of the arm, and I just leapt off the couch and had to run kind of like half a mile home. No blue people, don't bump into blue people, you know? And it freaked me out, and I didn't sleep that night, and I had to go back, you know, later on and actually go, come on, can we put that film on again and sit through it to get over that and to actually watch it. But the first time I tried, I took off down the street. It absolutely scared the bejesus out of me.
And suddenly, so I mean, it is all of them, all three of them that are really scary in their own ways. But this one, because there's this attempt to have a normal life and things not working out. The music once again playing a big part. But just very briefly, so you and I, as I mentioned when we started, you know, we've had many movie adventures, including going to Comic-Con events. And our very first Comic-Con in London, many, many years ago, you and I had the pleasure of meeting the man, George Romero,
Godfather
of the zombie genre. And if I may just very quickly, I'm just going to show to camera, I think it will work that way.
Yep.
I've got him to sign my DVD. This is Dawn of the Dead, but the director's cut. And signed by George Romero, and also have another picture signed by him. And he was such a gentleman. He was such a gentle soul.
Cool guy.
Yeah, he was really, really nice and softly spoken.
Somebody's granddad, you know. that's what he came across as.
You're the man that scared me. When
I'm like, dude, why'd they bite an arm off? Why'd the blue guy bite an arm off?
I love the whole, and the remake by Zack Snyder.
I love that too. In a different way, for a different reason.
And The thing about this one, I love the whole idea of let's get into the supermarket and try and build a life there. Things go wrong after a while, but
it's kind of that whole, I mean, with zombies have never really fallen out of fashion. Kind of, it's one of them ones that most horror fans love, a good zombie film, and it is hard to keep them original. But there's just something about that kind of relentless, slow shamble. That is creepy as all hell. And again, if you for 1 minute try and put yourself in the position of what it would feel like to be in that situation and not be blasé about it and be like, well, I'll just stab him in the head, you know, it would be horrific in every sense of the word, you know, especially if it was somebody you knew or a loved one or whatever. And the reality of that kind of horror is amazing, and I think he pulled it off so well, considering it was guerrilla filmmaking in the early days to make this kind of thing. The budget was next to nothing. I believe a lot of the extras were paid $1. they got a t-shirt, a Dawn of the Dead t-shirt, and they got a kind of a donut or a muffin or something as well. That was their fee for being in it, you know, and to pull off something that, you know, 40 years later, people will still talk about and watch is a testament to the genius behind it.
No, absolutely. And like I said, you know, he just wanted to tell a story. Yes, there was, you know, subtext and so on, but in terms of caring for the characters and wanting them to survive and do well,
yeah.
So when things don't go so well, you're panicked, stricken, like, as they are, and they have to find a way to survive, which is amazing. So my final selection then for this extended version of, you know, Back in Time is this one, which I've watched several times, and every time, you know, it just gets to me. And of course, this is The Exorcist, as I'm just bringing the poster in full view for you and I. So, I mean, this one was, once again, a VHS cassette from a friend of a friend. I wasn't supposed to watch it. I put it up, and honestly, when it was finished, I was exhausted. Like, I felt like I'd gone through what the order that they've gone through. And
this is another one that's supposed to be true as well, and based on true accounts. And the minute you're told that, it's always in your head when you go to watch it too.
And I remember, you know, so I didn't tell anybody that I'd seen it, but clearly something had happened to me because of my head. What's wrong with you? Nothing. You know, and I wanted to find ways to, you know, not have Pazuzu, the demon, because I didn't even knew I learned his name from that point on. There was such things as demon that could possess you. But the whole last chapter or act of the film, which is essentially the exorcism, is just harrowing to watch, to endure as an audience. And I don't think it's been equaled to this point. If you watch it now, you'd see the very crude practical effects, I grant you.
Yeah.
But in terms of, by that point, it's a bit like Steven Spielberg with Joe saying, by the time they see the shark, I've got them. I've got the audience with me. And I think with The Exorcist, by the time you get to The Exorcism, you're in it, and you see the two priests and so on and so forth. And I mean, to me, that was one of those where, in a way, it's an amazing contribution to the genre, but a film that is just, till to this day, exhausting to watch because so much goes on. It's so loud. It's so gory. But the one scene that I remember vividly when I was watching the film on got to me is when the young priest plays the old magnetic band, you know, backwards. So he plays them forwards, and it's just kind of lots of howling and growling and shouting. Makes no sense. He stops those old-fashioned magnetic bands, and then plays them backwards, and suddenly he hears a language that you know, he can understand. And that was it. I was just kind of, you know, I've said myself, I should stop watching this because I'm getting very scared now to the point where...
like the imagery is the thing that sticks with me. I mean, even on the poster there, that, you know, the light and the silhouette, again, the shape that's backlit and everything else is black. And, you know, the steps, people still visit the steps from The Exorcist now, like people visit the steps from Rocky, you know. It's become so iconic. You know, people are still going there, getting their photograph taken at night on The Exorcist steps. There's something about those visuals and the way they're framed and the way they're captured that is just eerie, and it plays on your psychology. I never actually saw this when I was a kid.
Right.
I think, you know, it was like a lot of movies were banned in this country. And for some reason, I never got to saw this till much later, till I was an adult. And I had to watch it as an adult, having watched millions of horror films. And I didn't find it particularly scary at that point.
Of course, yeah.
But I could see why, when it was released, that people were terrified of it, and it was so well made, and the tie-in with, you know, is it true, is it not, is it, how much of it is true, it was a brilliant piece of filmmaking, a brilliant piece of art, in that I can imagine going to the cinema, people for the first time would pass out and faint, you know, the stories of that happening. To me, the biggest interesting thing of The Exorcist is the controversy of the making of it, and in some ways arguably that the making of The Exorcist was more scary than the film itself and what the actors and actresses and went through to put this thing on screen. And, you know, the fact that the room that they were in was actually in a freezer, so they dropped the temperature down to kind of minus 15, minus 20, and they're having to act so that you could see the breath and things like that. And, you know, it's easy to criticize a movie, but until you know what's gone into it, I think, you know, then you think, wow, this is amazing just for our scares or entertainment. And
absolutely.
I think it's genius filmmaking.
Yeah. So that's the final selection for Back in Time, a extended edition of this segment because of this horror special. Once again, thank you for joining us for number 3 of Film with Films. This is our monthly video magazine. We've got people like
comments.
Jenny Weatherburn saying
hello. Oh, hiya, Jenny.
Nico's come back with a comment. We've got James, we've got Liam, we've got Aaron Oates as well.
Aaron. Hi, Aaron.
Nico is asking, but might as well use that now, what do you think about the Zombieland franchise when comedy meets horror?
When comedy meets horror, I genuinely like if it's done well. One of my favorite movies is Monster Squad. Can you remember Monster Squad? Again, the Goonies meets monsters, and they've used in that one the old school Wolfman and Dracula and Frankenstein and the Mummy, and there's a whole Wolfman has nards, kick him in the nards scene. When it's done well, I absolutely love it, but it's not often done well, in my opinion. And I do think Zombieland, the first one, does do it well. I thought it was absolute genius. It was brilliant. I love how, you know, you've got the do the cardio, you know, number one rule, and, you know, all of that kind of thing, and how it pops up on the screen. It's visually engaging as well as it's a cool idea and cool writing. And Woody Harrelson is just brilliant as per usual. I didn't enjoy the second one as much. I don't think it quite had the charm of the first one, and I don't think it was as well written. Again, personal opinion, but I adore the first one, and I think if it's done right.
Yeah, good answer, right. I think another one that comes to mind where it's done right is Dog Soldiers, which
I
mentioned today, you know, just because it's a British production, but also because mix of comedy and horror, because there's some really scary bits in it, but also it will, you know, give you that moment where you can smile and have the relief. And I think that was probably where The Exorcist didn't do it. There was no letter,
no relief
whatsoever.
Even going back to American Werewolf in London, it is essentially a black comedy, the whole thing, but there's times you can jump out your seat, and I think that is great when somebody can play that line well. I just don't think many people can do it. There's a lot of actors can't pull it off, but there's certainly a lot of directors can't pull it off either. It's difficult to do comedy. It's difficult to do good horror, but to put them together is really difficult. So if you get something like Zombieland that isn't universally critically and, you know, critically panned and panned by everybody that sees it, you're onto a winner straight away, because it isn't easy to do. So to even do it remotely well, you've done well. That's my point.
Absolutely. Well, listen, we are reached the final segment of today's show, and we're going to continue to have fun, but with you this time. We have prepared some tricksy questions. This is now time to move on to the Fun with Films quiz.
Dun, dun, dun. And here we go. This has, from what I understand, become the favourite part of the show.
Yes, people usually start with that if you watch on a replay. So riddle me this, riddle me that. What we've done is prepare 3 questions each. That's 6 in total. We're going to ask you the questions. We're going to play a little something to give you time to think it through. Then we're going to come back and give you the answers, or maybe ask each other the questions. And then in the comments, you can let us know how many points you got right. But remember, this is the horror special. So in the comments, if you just joined us live or on replay, do put in the film that scared you first? You know, perhaps at this younger age, what was the very first scary movie you watched? I'm going to say a quick hello to Helen Howard as well, who just joined us live. Hi, Helen. Thank you for your support. So, well, your first question, Paul.
Right. I don't know. I think Pascal's got an image he may want to show for this, but...
Oh, no, I don't have him. So...
You had one job.
You had one
job. Okay, first question. Going back to Nosferatu, which I think is highly, highly influential in filmmaking. 1922, this film was made, and the original vampire look with the teeth at the front that was used in Salem Lot was Nosferatu. Right, in the whole film, Count Orlok, which is Nosferatu, appears for about 9 minutes in the whole movie, in this 1922 black and white creepy, creepy, creepy movie, still creepy today. How many times does Count Orlok blink in the whole of his 9 minutes on screen in that movie? That's question number one.
Okay. Question number two, about Stephen King. I'm sure you'll agree, the master of the horror genre, certainly in books. Which Stephen King novel was the first movie adaptation?
Of his book.
Of his book, right. Yeah. So, one Stephen King novel was adapted for the movie. Which title was it? The very first one. If you're a fan of horror films, you should find that one reasonably easy. Your next question, Paul.
All right. Well, I was going to ask, in The Exorcist, what is the name of the possessing demon?
Well, actually, we'll see if they've been listening.
But Pascal gave that away.
Only because already. Of the demon.
He said. It's never actually revealed in the film, though, is it? I don't believe it's revealed in the film.
Well, I know the name from somewhere, because I'm still scared.
That's another factoid that may or may not want to write in about. So we've got a bonus if you listen to Pascal, the name of the demon from The Exorcist. But I'll give you another. It's a two-part question now. The director of The Exorcist was very famous for using extreme ways to get reactions from his cast. Now, give me one of those extreme ways he would shock the cast so that he could get the reaction on film. That's okay. A question.
Question number two from... So I'm going on to my next question regarding Freddy Krueger, who clearly is going to kill me because you refused to obviously defend me against Freddy Krueger.
I'm not going there.
If you're a fan of the films and the franchise, you'll know of Freddy's nursery rhyme. 1, 2, Freddy's coming for you. 3, 4... Better lock your door. 5, 6, grab the crucifix. 7, 8, gonna stay up late. 9, 10, over to you. What is the final line of Freddy Krueger's nursery rhyme? Starting
with excellent. 1, 2, good Freddy's question.
Coming you. 9, 10, what is it? Over to you. Question from you.
The last question. Question number 6. My third question in the Halloween movies. The Shape. Michael Myers. My mate. I like him. Wears a mask. Very, very famous white-faced mask. That mask was the facial mask of somebody very famous, another famous star, somebody close to my heart. Absolutely love this guy. Who was it?
Great. Final question. An easier one, I think, for big fans of the Insidious franchise and the Conjuring franchise. You'll know the couple, Ed and Lorraine Warren. And unluckily, they found a doll that they keep in their basement. What is the name of that infamous and scary doll that is also having, is on movies, actually, spin-offs? So the name of the doll found by the couple from the Conjuring franchise.
Not Insidious.
Insidious as in the same filmmakers.
Right.
I think they are more in the Conjuring.
The Conjuring, right?
Conjuring, yeah. Ed and Lauren Warren, right. The couple of kind of psychic and... So that's
just be clear, not the Insidious movies, the Conjuring movies. Yeah. Right.
The doll.
The doll.
So these are your 6 questions about horror films. Just to give you a bit of time to reflect on it, we've chosen a little scene to kind of pass a bit of the time. People playing games as well as we are. This time they are from The Evil Dead.
It's a 7.
What suit?
Diamonds. Hearts.
Oh my god, 7 of hearts, you're right.
Hey Ash, I guessed the card right.
Yeah, truly amazing, Linda.
I don't know, but I think it's really some sort of extra sense or something, you know, like ESP.
Okay, try this.
Okay,
It's a seven.
I don't believe it!
Of spades. Queen of spades. Four of hearts. Eight of spades. Two spades. Jack of diamonds. Jack of clubs.
Why have you disturbed our sleep? Awakened us from our ancient slumber. You will die! Like the others before you. One by one, we will take you.
I'm not playing that card game ever. Okay, well, I hope you've enjoyed listening to the questions, thinking it through. Enjoy this scene from The Evil Dead, the very first one. Question number one again, Paul.
Okay, Nosferatu, Count Orlok, played by Max Schreck, I believe it was. How many times does he blink throughout the whole film? He was on screen for 9 minutes. How many times does he blink?
All right, so put your answers in the comments or in the form below. I'm going to say just a once when he's hit by the sunlight.
You're correct. It is just the once, but it's not when he's hit by the sunlight. It's in one of the very opening scenes.
Okay.
Well done.
No, just once, but at the wrong
just
time.
Once.
Okay. So, what is the name of the Stephen King's novel that was the very first movie adaptation?
See, this I don't know. I'm gonna have to guess. I think Salem's Lot was the second, I believe. Okay. I don't think it was the first. Was it The Shining?
It was not.
Cujo?
It wasn't.
No. Okay, I give up.
It was Carrie.
Carrie? Oh my God, yeah, I forgot about it. Yeah. I forgot that was even Stephen King.
Yeah, yeah.
She, Sissy Spacek, slept in blood clothes for 3 days to get into character for that.
Yeah, yeah. Good adaptation, actually. Very good classic Brian De Palma, if I'm not mistaken. Your next question was?
Next question. Well, two-parter now. So The Exorcist, the name of the possessing demon, which Paz gave away earlier on, was?
Pazuzu.
Pazuzu. Pazuzu. I know what's going on.
Mm.
See what I did
I've
there?
I've been researching ways to protect myself against it.
Yeah. Against himself. Yeah. Okay. So the other part is, what extreme ways did the director go to get the shock look from his cast on screen? There's two that I know of. Could have been more. Any one of them will do.
Okay. Well, the one that's been well documented is when he fired the shotgun in the scene where she's up in the attic looking for something, just to get that kind of
it was
starter
a
look.
Starter pistol.
Was it? Yeah.
Fired a starter pistol. Yeah. Kind of behind the cast. Yeah. I believe as well on the documentaries for this, one of the other ones was he would actually slap them across the face just before the film. Get that look. A very extreme way of doing things, and neither of us condone that kind of thing. We just put that out there, yeah, but that's the answer. Okay.
Okay.
Next.
So for me, I was talking about the Freddy Krueger's nursery rhyme. 1, 2, Freddy's coming for you. 3, 4, 5, 9, 10. The answer is never sleep again.
Never sleep again.
So that is, the answer to that one. Freddy, I think it was introduced much later on, not the first one, that nursery rhyme, Freddy Krueger.
Can't actually remember whether it was in the first one or not.
I think a bit later. Maybe the
third one, Dream Warriors.
Classic, really. Just saying quick hello to Bob Gentle and Johnny Ross, joining us live as well.
Hi, guys.
Your next question for Riddle.
My
this
final.
Me that.
Halloween, the Michael Myers character wears a mask, the shape. The mask was originally of a very famous character and actor, and it was sprayed from its normal color, white, and had a very strange and odd eerie look, but who was it a mask of originally?
Okay, if you haven't already, put it in the comments. I've read several times it was William Shatner.
It was Captain Kirk.
But I don't know whether it's urban legend.
Nope.
I don't know if that's true.
Nope, it was a Captain Kirk mask. Because when it was made, obviously, Star Trek was still hugely popular.
Mm-hmm. Well, they've done a good job because it's not recognisable as William Shatner.
It was a really bad Captain Kirk mask, and I think that was the thing. When they were looking for something, because I think originally maybe the character was just supposed to be a face, and they thought, you know, we can't just show his face. It's not really scary. Go get a mask, and it's kind of like, well, what mask do I get? And I think the mask actually didn't really look like anything or like anyone. It didn't look like Kirk, certainly. It was very poorly made, and that was part of it. It was very ambiguous. And again, it is scary because of that.
It's not crazy now that the mask wearing, you know, from all the kind of other horror films that we know of, is really something that we as people find very difficult to deal with.
Yeah, it's that lack of features. Mm. You know, that blank look, as soon as you can't see what people are thinking, it becomes scary.
Yeah, absolutely.
And especially people's posture and body language. If that's menacing, but you can't read that on a face, it's horrific.
Talking of blank looks and lack of expression, so the name of the doll that was found by Ed and Lauren Warren from the Conjuring franchise and other... people who've seen the films may remember it. It also some spin-off with just that doll terrorizing families.
I'm going to say it's Annabelle.
It is Annabelle.
Annabelle.
Which is actually a lovely name, but that, you know, once it's affixed to this creepy-looking doll, then that's it.
Joe couldn't watch that. If it's got dolls or clowns or if it's in any way, shape or form scary, but yeah, dolls, she freaks out.
Super. Everyone... Sadly, this is the end of Fun With Films, the horror special. This was number 3 of our monthly video magazine. We've gone through a lot of content for you. In Watchmen, we give you our 6 recommendations of Hidden Gems on Netflix for Paul and Amazon Prime for me. We've reacted to the trailer of Ghostbusters Afterlife.
I'm looking forward to that.
We asked each other the big question, so you now know that if Freddy Krueger attacks me, indeed... The other two, Jason Voorhees and Mike Myers, I may survive. And you also have learned that I'd be prepared to eat the toenail of
Baba Yaga
to be able to watch a film in peace and quiet.
What you've really found out is he doesn't like going to the cinema with other people.
Yeah. I mean, the only reason I want to be very rich, and the only reason, but one reason I want to be very rich is to be able to book entire cinema. Maybe for just you and I, so long as you keep quiet.
I'm pretty good. I am good. I've had to learn to be pretty. I mean, I'm intolerant as all hell in the cinema, but he's worse.
Yeah. We then have an extended version of Back in Time. It's been an absolute pleasure to hear from Paul, and hopefully you've enjoyed my revelations in terms of the movies that scared us the most when we were much younger. And thank you for taking part in this month's quiz as well, all about horror films. Thank you very much for being an amazing co-host as well.
You're welcome, my friend. And as always, it's an absolute pleasure. And I'm sad we have to end it now.
Okay, so we'll be back next month for another edition of the monthly video magazine. Please leave comments, suggestions about films you would like us to talk about. Talk about you, the films that you want us to review as well. And until the next time, please go out there and watch amazing movies.
And enjoy.
Pazuzu.